The following program is brought to you free of charge by the sponsorship of Novus Ordo Watch. See for yourself that the Church of the Second Vatican Council is not in fact the Catholic Church of the Ages. Go to novusordowatch.org. That's novusordowatch.org.
Conversations on the Crisis. I am your host, Stephen Heiner, and we are joined today by our regular guest, His Excellency Bishop Donald Sanborn of Most Holy Trinity Seminary and Father Anthony Chicada of St. Gertrude the Great Catholic Church. Your Excellency, Father, thank you for joining us.
Hi, Stephen. Hello.
Clerical Conversations on the Crisis is a production of Restoration Radio, and we try to encounter different topics each month that relate to what has happened since the Second Vatican Council. Today's topic is Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre. One of the challenges of having a dead figure in the traditional movement is that sometimes people will try to arrogate the ghost of the archbishop and say what the archbishop would do here, what he would do there. Not only is that problematic, but it also sometimes takes away focus from what originally was attractive about the man in the first place. What was his character like? How did he conduct himself with other priests? What drew people to him? And most of the priests that have been ordained by the Society of St. Pius X in the last quarter of a century never met the archbishop because he passed away in 1991. And so with us today are two members of the clergy who not only knew the archbishop but were ordained by him. So I think, Your Excellency, I can start with you. Do you remember how you heard of the archbishop, when you first met him, and what impressions you had from your first meeting?
Yes, it was back in 1971, winter of 1971. I and others were utterly disgusted with the Novus Ordo Seminary and the prospects of the future. I would say to myself, I don't want to be in the same rectory with these people when I'm in my 50s. And I would just look around and look at the condition of what was in the seminary. I mean, between heresy and various forms of immorality and just all sorts of things. I just wanted nothing to do with it. Crazy masses and then the word from the major seminary was that, you know, while the masses were not quite as crazy, the theology was crazier, that it was more modernistic. And I and others decided to try to, the first way we tried to solve that problem was to go to other dioceses to see if they were more conservative. And, well, that didn't work out. In some cases, they seemed to be more liberal. And so that was a dead end. And finally, one of the seminarians wrote away to a publication known as The Voice that was put out in Canandaigua, New York. It has since passed away. But it was a hard line, little paper, that was a place in which a lot of people met each other. At that time, there was no internet or anything. People would write in, and it was a sort of an underground, small circulation little paper. And this one seminarian wrote in and said, "Does anybody know of any Catholic conservative seminary out there?" And a priest from Kentucky, and I can't remember his name right now.
Father Ramsey, I think.
Ramsey, yeah. Yes. Yeah. Wrote back and said, yes, there is an archbishop in Europe who is founding a seminary in Switzerland. Now, he had just founded it, because this would have been, he founded it in, the fall of 1970, We were writing this in about January of 71, so this was pretty early on. And so it was a fledgling thing at that point. And so I wrote to him and arranged to meet with him. And on March 15th, 1971, I and now Bishop Kelly And now Father Anthony Ward met with him in New York on that day, on March 15th, 1971. And he was accompanied by an English seminarian. And
Was he visiting New York, or did you did he come on your request, or was he just in town?
He was. His main purpose for being in the United States was to visit the Bishop of Covington, Kentucky, because the Bishop of Covington, Kentucky, was a father of the Holy Ghost. In other words, that sounds funny.
Okay.
He was a Holy Ghost father. That's a little heresy there for you. He was a Holy Ghost father, and he hoped, because Archbishop Lefevre had been the Superior General of that order, and he hoped that the Bishop of Covington would provide a place to have a seminary in his diocese. So the idea was to show him that the Bishop of Fribourg accepted his pious union, and that the Bishop of Sion in Switzerland accepted to have a house in his diocese. And the idea would be, why don't you permit us to set up a seminary or a house or whatever in your diocese? That was the whole point of it. So the meeting in New York worked in well with the going to Ohio. Later he said that all that the bishop wanted to do was talk about his dog. When I asked him later how did it go out in Covington, he said all he wanted to do was talk about his dog. So he obviously put him off. And from that point of view, it was not a success. But he did meet with us. We had dinner with him and talked to him at length. So I had a very nice impression of him. So did the other two.
So I'm assuming, Your Excellency, you both, all three of you, spoke French at least passingly well enough to have a conversation. Because I can't imagine the Archbishop spoke English.
No,
very
that's
well.
Why the English seminarian was there.
Oh, okay.
He spoke French perfectly, and obviously English perfectly, and we got along that way. I didn't know enough French at the time to really communicate with him, to any extent.
So, what were your impressions from the dinner, and then afterwards, you and the now Bishop Kelly and Father Ward? What did you all think? What did you come away with from that?
Well, we all had an excellent impression of him as a person. And he always gave an excellent impression as a person. I mean, he gave the impression of an intelligent man who was at the same time very pious and serious about his faith. He was very firm about the necessity to hold on to the traditional Mass. Now, remember, this is 1971, so we're already in the new Mass time. And for that time, he said some very firm things against the modernists. And I say for that time because today we have much higher standards, so to speak, and we've all studied the problem much more than we did in 1970 or 71. I mean, I was still laboring at that time under the idea that Paul VI was a wonderful pope who was surrounded by an evil entourage, and that he was powerless to do anything, and the reason for all of the chaos in the church was because of the evil entourage. I mean, I was still thinking that. So for his time, he was saying some very, very good things against modernism and the changes. And that really dazzled all of us because we were constantly hearing from the clergy just the opposite. It was very discouraging at the time. To be a traditionalist at that time was to be a nut. I mean, everyone was against you. What are you, crazy that you want to go back to this? And you were just a handful of people, a tiny, tiny handful, and despised at that. So to hear somebody say the things, and especially an archbishop of the church, to say the things that you believed as well, was something that was very heartening. All of those things, contributed to a very, very good impression of him. All of us were very dazzled, you might say, in a good sense, by him.
Right. Well, and I would say, some things maybe don't change. A tiny handful of despise, it doesn't sound that different 40 years on, I guess.
Oh, you have no idea. You have no idea, Stephen.
Definitely it's night and day, I'm sure.
Oh, I mean, Father Chicata remembers, if you were at any kind, if the idea that, you thought that Paul VI was great, but he had the evil entourage, if you opposed the new changes at all, you were considered really and truly to be a nut. There was something wrong with you psychologically. And you were just an outcast, a complete outcast, and there was no mainstream in it. Now the traditional movement is a worldwide movement that at least people recognize. You felt so isolated in those times. Only Father Chicata could confirm that. He's old enough.
Sure. I mean, that's absolutely true. You had you did not know what was going on. You didn't have the means of communications that we have now to, say, communicate with someone like Bishop Sanborn, who was out in a seminary in New York. I was isolated. Basically, there's a small group of us at the seminary in Milwaukee. And you had the same idea that, Paul VI was an evil entourage. And you, of course, were trying to be loyal to him. But, at the same time, you very much had the feeling that, you were an outcast.
Mm-hmm.
You both are describing it, I would think, is it like how our society would perceive a 9/11 truther? It's like, it's crazy to talk about that, and it's a forbidden topic. Was it something like that?
Yeah, well, not this. Everything was coming up roses at that time. The changes were still had all of the energy of the normal church, the Pius XII church. So there were vocations, the seminaries were still filled up. Everything was just going and moving quickly. And you were just missing the boat. And what's wrong with you? Why don't you get on this vessel? You're some sort of a dinosaur, and you were held in utter contempt, and as if you were crazy. And why don't you just get out of here? That was the and you felt, at least I did. I felt very isolated.
Yes, and the. You would actually be told sometimes that you're crazy, you have a psychological problem, that you're attached to all of this old stuff, you are rigid psychologically,
you can't go along
with the times, it's immature, and so on. And all of these arguments were trotted out at you by the modernists. And when you're on the receiving end of something like that, you are quite isolated.
And when you're 19, 20, 21, when you're browbeaten like that, you don't have a lot of response. You just feel sort of crushed by it. So that was the context of the whole thing.
And whatever, if you would see something in the way of theological error or liturgical abuses, as we would talk about them in those days, there was nothing you could do about them.
No.
There's absolutely nothing you could do about them that any complaints would be ignored by the authorities, and you would be treated as someone who's crazy for bringing this stuff up.
Yes, I remember that.
Yeah.
Bishop Sanborn was in seminary in New York when he... You were in the seminary at the time, right, Your Excellency?
Yeah, I was in what they call the college seminary.
Okay.
And that's where you did your philosophy and humanities before going to the major seminary, which was 4 years of theology and philosophy. And, I really had no intention of going to the major seminary in that diocese, and I don't think they wanted me either. I had made such a fuss. You can just imagine.
I can't imagine your.
Yeah, you know, I tend to be soft-spoken, but you know, just imagine the way I am now, but with all of the enthusiasm of youth. I used to say some pretty bold things, and I don't think they wanted any part of me. So, you know, it was sort of a dead-end street. And so Archbishop Lefebvre came along exactly at the right moment for me because I really didn't know what to do. I had exhausted the idea of transferring to another diocese, and I really didn't know what to do. So he just sort of came at the right moment.
Well, I think that would probably be an apt way of describing how that came along for you too, Father Chicada. You were not at a seminary, but you were at a monastery at the time, correct? And then they had sent you
well,
over to...
Well, the monastery was sort of the last stop on a journey where I was trying to figure out what to do, because I experienced in the seminary high school and then eventually in the seminary college in Milwaukee, what, you know, Bishop Sanborn just described, all this crazy stuff. And then at the end of your, it just simply got worse and worse in terms of the things that you were being taught and the things that were going on at the seminary and the what was being done in Mass. And so you looked around for a refuge, and I ended up in monastic order that liturgically was quite conservative, the Cistercians, and I figured that this would be a solution because you would be away from everything. You would be away from the insanity of parish life. You had a monastic life and a liturgical life. We had the new Mass, but you had everything. Everything except the readings, everything was in Latin. So you were isolated pretty much from what was going on, and I thought that this would be really a solution for myself. But they ended up, the Cistercians ended up sending me to Europe in 75. So my involvement with the society is a bit later than Bishop Sanborn's, about 3 or 4 years later. And at that point in 75, I was assigned to reside at this very nice medieval monastery with beautiful beautiful chant and a wonderful atmosphere. But then I discovered that the students were learning the same sort of errors that I had been taught at the diocesan seminary in Milwaukee, so that was quite upsetting. But for me, at the same time, then there was a controversy over Archbishop Lefebvre and over his seminary in the press in Switzerland, and I found this very interesting. And we had a recreation room in the monastery, and they would have the two daily papers in there, two Swiss daily papers, and I remember reading about Archbishop Lefebvre and his battles with the modernists, and agreeing with him, saying, you know, thinking this guy knows what he's talking about. He's put his finger on the problem in the church. And as the life in the monastery was becoming more and more intolerable, because you realize what sort of theology you were going to be learning, then I decided that I would leave the order and join Archbishop Lefebvre.
So tell us a little bit about your first meeting with him and what the impressions were.
Well, actually, I don't believe I met him personally right away. I returned to America in July of that year, and then went to Econe, which is in southern Switzerland, where the Archbishop and his seminary were located, in September, in the fall. And impression one got of him at first was, you know, the public impression of him, certainly as, you know, a very eloquent preacher. Even though my French was not all that good at that point. I could make it out, and you could tell that he really had something to say in the way in which he expressed himself. And he said Mass in a very devout way, and conducted himself as one would expect a good religious superior to conduct himself, his personal bearing and so on. I was familiar with that from being in the Cistercian order, and you could tell by looking at him and how he acted in community life that he really had what they would call the right stuff.
I guess this question would be both for both of you, Your Excellency and Father. How was he as a professor? And I know you had said, you started, Your Excellency, by saying he said some very strong stuff at the time. So I suppose we can kind of relate that to how he was as a professor. Was he sometimes very strong in class and sometimes a little bit more, I think Bishop Sanborn would use the phrase accommodationist, or what? In the early days, was it always quite strong in the classroom?
He was never in the classroom. He gave spiritual conferences from time to time, and they were very good. He certainly knew his ascetical theology, and he had a lot of common sense in the spiritual life as well. Everybody enjoyed his spiritual conferences, and he stuck pretty much to the topic. He didn't use the spiritual conference as an indoctrination session or anything like that. He kept to his subject very well, and but he was never in the classroom. He would have been great in the classroom, I think, but
yeah.
He was very much a missionary, and he never really stayed around for more than 5 days, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
He was very much on the road, and that's how he managed to build up the Society of St. Pius X. For the reason that he constantly, I mean, don't forget, he started out at age 65 in this whole project. He was 65 in 1970. So he was constantly on the road in Europe by car, almost always by car. Mm-hmm. And then he was going all around the world eventually. He was a missionary. He was not the type of person to sit at home or to... He was not sedentary in any way whatsoever. So he was never in the classroom. We did hear conferences from him, and they were very good. And all of that was very positive about him.
As one gets older, you appreciate what a sacrifice it is to travel when you're older. In the 60s, and I often think about him when I have to travel around to do something myself. I mean, he went all over the place, these terrifically strenuous journeys.
And, I mean, I'm approaching 65, and I would like to quit.
and that's just when he got started.
Yeah, that's when he got. I always think about that. I mean. To drag yourself on those planes and just all that travel is very strenuous, especially as you get older. Your circulation isn't as good, and your muscles don't work as well, and there's all kinds of problems that come up. Yeah.
Father Chicada, do you have anything to add on to what His Excellency was saying about his interaction at the seminary, spiritual conferences, that sort of thing?
Well, it was this... the same thing. We did not have him, my generation did not have him in class either. Bishop Sanborn was ordained the year before I arrived, and we didn't have any classes by Archbishop Lefebvre, but the spiritual conferences were really quite excellent. He gave not only spiritual conferences, but then he would talk about the situation vis-a-vis Paul VI and what was going on there. And those, of course, were always quite interesting. And being seminarians, you know, we had our ears open very much for what he was for what he would say, the different things that he would report. So.
And you both talked about travel, so I'm thinking you may not have traveled with him very much as seminarians, but you probably, especially as sort of the vanguard of the American fleet, you could say, traveled quite a bit with him here in the United States. What was he like when he was traveling? What did you observe about him? What did you notice in the way that people reacted to him, lay people or clergy? What was that traveling like with him?
Well, he was always very simple in his tastes as far as travel was concerned. He never stayed in any kind of posh situation. As a matter of fact, I remember in Rochester, New York, there was prepared for him some sort of imperial suite or something in the nicest hotel in Rochester. He refused to stay in it. He was, as a religious, I think he was faithful to his vow of poverty as much as you can be when you travel. I think actually when you become a bishop, you're dispensed of it for that mm-hmm. reason, but he still lived up to the spirit of it. I mean, he was never one to travel in style, so to speak, and I think in almost all cases he went over in coach class, which was a little bit better than now. I mean, because planes were usually half full or so, you know. But nevertheless, he traveled in economy almost all the time, and he just had very simple tastes and all of that, even though he came from a fairly well-to-do family in northern France. So I think that he took very seriously his vow of poverty. He was very energetic in seeing the faithful and giving speeches, and he would stay up late night, and, you know, if there were a conference. And he was never one to put off a meeting with lay people in order to promote the cause, always. And now I don't know how he did it. I mean, I really don't know how he did it. He had a great deal of zeal with regard to that. And the people, of course, loved him. He had a persona that was immediately, the only word is attractive. I mean, immediately you were drawn to him. Everybody was. There was something about him that pulled you. It was he was at once pleasant but serious, and he was approachable, but never got too close. You know, he had a good sense of humor, but he never said the wrong thing. Mm-hmm. And so he just had a perfect balance in his personality and his character, probably from his piety and his practice as a religious. I would say a great deal of that was due to that. And so he was immediately attractive, and immediately you were ready to kind of surrender your intellect to him, you know, that we'll just follow you, tell us what to do, we'll follow you. And that happened a great deal, I noticed, you know, that he was very presentable, so to speak, and people were drawn to him.
As in, he, in pursuit of promoting the cause, he was also very energetic in terms of publicity and talking with the press, handling the press, and being very very conscious of that he had an important cause to promote, and that it was not just about him, but that there was a larger point to what he was doing. So he seemed to be, very much aware of that, and he knew really, I think, how to use the publicity very effectively to get the points across that he wanted to get across. And that was very good for the cause.
Yeah.
I would say both of you probably learned from that.
If the Society of St. Pius X is as big as it is today, it's because he put so much energy into founding it.
Mm. When I think about what you're saying about personal religious habits, I think sometimes lay people, we're not we're not in that situation where we get to travel with clergy, or we are within, you know, Father Chicago alluded to having lived in a monastery, having been part of that life. And that's obviously a different, there's a different perspective when you're a secular priest, not in a religious order. What were some personal habits of piety, you may not have adopted them yourself, or something that you incorporated, something where this was something particular to him, or something you thought that was just a really good habit ingrained at the time that clearly was not part of what the Novus Ordo clergy even thought about, that the contrast between where you were coming from and what you were doing with him?
Ooh. Well, I think that he didn't do anything extraordinary, but what was extraordinary in him is that he followed the rules of piety very, very carefully and seriously. And that was very clear in him. I mean, he was a prayerful man, and you could tell that he was sticking to a rule. And he had a lot of self-discipline. That is extraordinary. for the general religious spirit to penetrate that much into a man is extraordinary. So it's maybe difficult for a layperson to understand that, but especially as a bishop, and especially mixing it in with travel. Travel tends to be very disruptive of all sorts of duties. It's unpredictable, but he overcame all of those obstacles, and I don't think anybody could fault him in any way whatsoever for a lack of personal piety and for obeying the rules.
Yeah, just to underline what Bishop Sanborn said, it's it is one thing to observe religious rule of life in a stable institution where you don't move around, but the fact that he was able to do this consistently on the road, he sort of took his monastery with him, and that was something that one noticed. I certainly noticed, and it was very impressive and very edifying.
Yes. Yes.
Well, for those of you who are just joining us, you are listening to Clerical Conversations on the Crisis. I'm your host, Ian Hunter, and we're joined by our regular guest, His Excellency Bishop Donald Sanborn of Most Holy Trinity Seminary in Brooksville, Florida, Father Anthony Chicotta of St. Gertrude of the Great Catholic Church, who's normally up in Westchester, Ohio, but is, I hope, enjoying warmer weather this week while he's a professor down at the seminary. It's a very cold day in the Midwest, Father, so I can only hope that it's a little warmer down in Florida.
It is.
We only got up to 80 today. It's been a little on the cool side.
For any lay people who were around when the Archbishop was here in the United States, we'd love to have you call in, share any of your personal stories. We know there might not be too many out there. Our telephone number is 949-272-9417. Again, that's 949-272-9417. And if you were old enough to have personally met the Archbishop and you're savvy enough to use Twitter, the two of you who I'm talking to can put your questions to us on Twitter using the handle @TrueRestoration. At this point, Your Excellency Father, someone who either has been listening to the show from the beginning or maybe tuned in halfway through, they're getting a little suspicious here. They're going to say, all right, what's the catch? Because you've only got good things to say about the Archbishop personally and about your experiences with him, but you're not part of the Society of St. Pius X anymore. So, in the spirit of consistency, Your Excellency and Father, how do you divide the edifying example you have of this man from the fact that you didn't stick to, his line? You said yourself that his habits made you want to submit to his to his way of life, and it made you feel relaxed. It was certainly not the antagonistic atmosphere you had at the Novus Ordo Seminary, where you were always on guard and you were alone. Now you were with people who wanted to celebrate the same Mass that you did, or at least there were a larger amount. How do you reconcile the fact that, you know, you took a different path? And I want to wrap up, into that how you dealt with the Archbishop regarding these matters, but to the person who's listening, who's shocked to find out that His Excellency and Father have anything good to say about Archbishop Lefebvre, what do you say to them?
Well, I would say this, that it's a, the question is, why did we go to Archbishop Lefebvre, and why did we go to the to his seminary in Switzerland? And the reason we did so is we wanted to be good priests who were faithful to Catholic teaching and who fought war against modernism. And that is why we went to Cologne, and why we got involved in the society. And there can be a difference between the those larger principles in terms of the life of the Church and what you feel obliged to do as a priest to battle error in modern times, and the respect and the high regard you have for someone's personal piety, such as we would have for Archbishop Lefebvre. When I was in the Cistercian order, there were a number of superiors who were extremely edifying as Archbishop Lefebvre was, in terms of their religious example and their personal piety and so on. But the reason I did not continue with them in the Cistercian order was over the larger doctrinal issue. And so that same thing would be applicable in the situation in the Society of St. Pius X, that while we certainly respected very much, were very aware of Archbishop Lefebvre's personal virtues, nevertheless, there, in many cases, on many issues, there was something beyond that. And that's where the disagreements came in.
Yes, I would concur with that. I would add this, that the 1970s were, especially at Icona, a great learning experience. And, you know, I entered with the thought, as I said, that Paul VI was, you know, this wonderful man that was essentially gagged in Rome. And that it was a good idea, Archbishop Lefebvre's idea of establishing houses with diocesan approval and working alongside, or if not alongside, at least in connection with the Novus Ordo clergy, that was a good solution to this whole problem. We could have our own little island, and we wouldn't bother them, they wouldn't bother us. That was what he was holding out at that time. That didn't bother me at all.
And you could build up brick by brick.
As someone said, yes.
But, you know, when you're in a traditional seminary and you have access to books, you talk to people, your focus is all different. You're starting to take in a lot of information, especially information that he himself gave us. So he was at the council, so he would tell us what went on at the council, and your jaw would drop because the council to you was another wonderful thing that was just misinterpreted by that evil entourage. And, so you hear, I mean, this bishop said this and this one said that. You hear all of these machinations, and you start thinking, and you're reading, and you're listening. And so I went through a whole development of my position at Acone. And so, as Father Cicatta said, you eventually came to a fork in the road that you saw what the Catholic faith demanded of you as a seminarian and a priest, and then you saw Archbishop Lefebvre's path as something that should not be, that is, of reconciling this group with the modernists. See, and that became a much darker picture, and So they gradually, little by little, you saw a dichotomy between his path and the church's path. And this was on the liturgical level and on it didn't enter doctrine too much, but how to deal with the problem.
Mm-hmm.
How to deal with the problem in the church. And that fissure became greater and greater, bigger and bigger, especially after 1978. In 1974, 5, and 6, and 7, it seemed as though he was on the path of saying, we can have nothing to do with the Novus Ordo. It seemed like as if he were going to do that. 1978, with the election of John Paul II, it all changed. And that's when he put himself on the path of reconciliation with the modernists, and we were on the path of anti-reconciliation, firmly there, and that's where the split already started to take place.
So I guess I would characterize that as he was on the accommodationist path and you were on the anti-accommodationist path.
Correct. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, definitely.
When I'm thinking about it, and you referred to, and obviously one of, I may not have shared this with you recently, Your Excellency Father, but the show that we did on Restoration Radio on the election of Francis I, most listened to show of all time, tens of thousands of listens, and we were talking about, you know, what happens in the post-Vatican II church when there's an election. And I wonder, you know, what was it like for you all at the time of the death of Paul VI? So in 1976, we have declarations like, we have nothing to do with this schismatic church. This schismatic church is not the Catholic Church. You want to suspend me? You know, you can't fire me. I quit. Kind of attitude from the Archbishop. What was the idea? It's like, okay, well, Paul VI is dead. Was there a hope that there was going to be either from the Archbishop or from your fellow clergy in the Society of St. Pius X at the time? Because, you know, we're looking at the most recent post-Vatican II papal conclave that we just mm-hmm. experienced. What was it like back then?
There was a hope that somehow the thing would turn around with if Cardinal Siri were elected. There was some sort of hope because it was still salvageable at that point. Vatican II was still young. It was the changes were still fresh in people's minds. There was still a large population that had been raised before Vatican II. So there was some thought that maybe it's like the Wicked Witch is dead. And now things will be better, you know. There was some thought of that, but really no one knew what would happen. It was a time of a great deal of lack of certitude. I just remember that day, August 6, 1978, as one of the happiest days of my life. I mean, and as I always point out, not only were we happy, but also the liberals were happy. He was like one of the most hated people. In history, I mean, nobody liked him. Everybody detested Paul VI. He was just a very unpopular person. Let's put it that way. And so it was lack of certitude. But you always hold out hope. I mean, you always wonder when God will intervene and set the thing aright. You know, and who knows how he will do that.
Yeah, I was just reading some of the accounts of Lady Thatcher dying in England, and people, you know, called in and said, I've been saving this bottle of champagne for 15 years. Mm-hmm. And so that sort of attitude, did you have a bottle of champagne that you had ready, Your Excellency, for
No,
that day?
Because he died quite suddenly and unexpectedly, at least, you know, as far as the news media was concerned. I just heard it. Somebody told me, you know, he died today. Nobody knew that he was approaching death, at least it was not being said. And no, there was no bottle of champagne. It was on a Sunday, actually, I remember it. And it was on a Sunday, and I had to say an afternoon mass. But I don't think anyone expected, though, the bear hug from John Paul II. And it was, I don't think anyone expected that John Paul II would attempt to reconcile Lefebvre. That was a surprise move.
Yes,
and,
yeah.
And the whole direction after all of the rhetoric for 3 or 4 years against the modernists and the conciliar church and on and on. It was a shock to see him start to get soft with the modernists and soft with John Paul II. That was a shock. And it was a worry, too.
Well, you mentioned some of these shocking things, and, you know, both of you have shared on different shows and on different occasions stories that he shared. And I think one of the things that a lot of lay people don't get to experience, that one of the things I really enjoy about visiting seminaries or religious places is table conversation, where you get to hear sort of some of the battle line stories, you know, what are priests dealing with out in the missions, and stories of, you know, good things and weird things that the faithful are doing. When you remember some of the sort of shocking things you heard either about Paul VI or about the council or about his interactions with post-Vatican II bishops, can you remember any stories that you remember him telling you and you remember being stunned by them?
I'm trying to think. Paul the Sixth, I don't know if he has any stories about Paul the Sixth. Well, he had that famous story of John.
Yeah, you told that story of John the 23rd. Some listeners might not know that, Your Excellency, if you want to share that.
Yes, he went to John the 23rd shortly after the election of John the 23rd. And don't forget, he was, I think at that point, Superior General of the Holy Ghost Fathers. And so he said to, he sat down with John the 23rd, and John the 23rd told him in the course of this conversation that one of the first things that he did after being elected was to go and look up his file at the Holy Office, and in it, it said, suspect of modernism. And he laughed and said to Archbishop Lefebvre, imagine me, a modernist. As if that were some absurd thing. And so that's I mean, I remember Archbishop Lefebvre telling me that story. That's very firsthand. As far as Paul VI, I don't think he had too much interaction with Paul VI. I can't remember any stories that he told about Paul VI, at least to me. And don't forget he was moved into France into a very poor diocese in France, Tulle, by John the 23rd, and so he was out of the Vatican in that sense. He was no longer apostolic delegate to French West Africa. He was confined to a little diocese in the late 60s. I have it wrong. He was apostolic delegate in the 50s and early 60s. Then he was, during the council, Superior General of the Holy Ghost Fathers. Then he was given, Tulle came in between. Then he was Superior General, and he resigned as Superior General in 1969. But in any case, I never heard him give any stories about Paul VI.
Okay.
Didn't he, you would remember this better than I, Your Excellency, didn't he also give, relay some John the 23rd anecdote about Fatima and the secret of Fatima?
Yes. There was a conference called, John the 23rd was about to open the secret of Fatima. And this was related to me directly by Archbishop Lefebvre. And on the day of the opening, he was not there for the opening. No one was there except, I think, Cardinal Ottaviani. But Cardinal Ottaviani had a little meeting with those who were invited after the opening. And this was in 1960. And Cardinal Ottaviani said, the Holy Father opened it, read it, put it back in the envelope, and put it back in the safe. and his only comment was, "This does not concern my pontificate."
Mm.
And that was the end of it.
Yeah.
All that was said. They were all expecting we're going to hear the secret.
Yeah.
And you know, again, mouths were dropping that this is all we get, is that's it. You know, it doesn't concern my pontificate, and there is no revelation of the secret. So, but that's a very accurately told story of what Archbishop Lefebvre told me. So that's I know he had a number of stories about Africa with eating monkey brains, I think. And
well, yeah, that might maybe not shock you, maybe more funny. I know I remember.
He was actually a good shot, and he said they would go up the river. I think he told us at dinner too. They would go up the river, and the natives would row the canoe, and he'd sit in the back with a rifle and shoot monkeys.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd go and get the monkeys he shot ashore, and then I guess attempt to dry them or something like that on the back of the boat. And he said he could never eat monkey, any part of the monkey. He'd generally just eat its brains.
Not exactly classic French cuisine.
No, definitely
rough in it.
He detached himself from all of that, and I always noticed that he was very cosmopolitan in this sense, that he adapted very well to any society or country that he was in, and he did not object to whatever, unless it was immoral or something. But, you know, as far as people's customs, he had no problem adapting to people's customs, which was very much in his favor, too. He actually shocked the French by wearing the black suit and ravi, what priests normally wear in this country and in England, Catholic priests. He shocked the French by wearing that to this country, because the French have this idea that the only proper attire on the street for a priest is a cassock, and that if you wear anything else, you're a modernist. So when we show up in France in a black suit and ravi, the way we walk around here, it's a terrible shock and scandal, because we're wearing a sandwich sign that says, "I am a modernist." Whereas he understood the customs, you know, whereas he always wore his habit or cassock in France, and when he went to England, this country, and Australia, he wore his black suit.
Yeah.
Well, Father, I've got a caller that I want to go and check if they have a question or a comment. In the meantime, I thought you might share the story about the French version of I do not say that there is no Pope, but and the sort of uproar that created at table. So I'll attend to the caller, and I'll leave you to share that story with our listeners, and I'll be back in a moment.
Oh, on that note, I will leave pronouncing the French to you, Your Excellency, lest I start a war between the United States and France.
I was about to say that, what you might come out with.
you never know what will happen. Well, but Stephen was talking about, I don't know if you were present, Your Excellency.
I was not, no.
You're not, yeah. I think it was after a first mass on Long Island, and we were having dinner at Oyster Bay with Archbishop Lefebvre, and there's a whole group of priests. And I actually was pressing him a little bit on the question of the Pope. And I set it up by saying, well, is in fact religious liberty a heresy? And he said, yes, it is in fact a heresy, and he explained that a little bit. And so then I took it to the next point and said, well, Paul VI, teaches this particular heresy. And then he knew exactly where I was going with this, and laughed and said, if you give the phrase, Your Excellency.
Je ne dis pas que le pape n'est pas pape, mais je ne dis pas non plus qu'on ne peut pas dire que le pape n'est pas pape.
Which means?
It means I don't say that the pope is not the pope, but I don't say either that one cannot say that the pope is not the pope.
So, and it sounded quite funny in French, and he was quite amused by the way he had formulated it for us, and we all had a good laugh. Mm-hmm. And I certainly took him at his word, but it wasn't terribly long after that that things got going again with John Paul II, and the Archbishop was sort of set on the reconciliation track. Mm-hmm. It was very soon after that, which was unfortunate. But, you know, he did say it, and, you know, I was certainly one of those who operated under the impression that he meant what he said, mm-hmm. that one could discuss those issues.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that, I don't know about your experiences with Archbishop Lefebvre as a seminarian, but I mean, there are a number of times that I simply went to ask him questions about different issues, and I didn't have a hesitation for doing that because I found him personally quite approachable.
He was very approachable.
Even for a seminarian, asking the questions, you'd go to his room and you'd knock on his door. And he would receive you, and you'd kind of put your question to him and get an answer.
Yes, he was very approachable and very open. I mean, you didn't get the impression that he was hiding anything from you or anything. You know, he was very good that way. I remember a little personal anecdote where I almost destroyed his ring. He had a beautiful ring and a huge amethyst, and I was preparing for some ceremony, and I was swinging the thurible to get the coals going. He comes around the corner, and that thurible just managed to hit that amethyst perfectly. Bang. And I just wanted to die. I mean, I didn't know he was coming. He was in a hurry. And he came quickly around the corner, and I hit his ring. I just wanted to die. But he was okay with it. He was not, you know, he just looked at it. He said, I hope it's not cracked. But he realized that, you know, it was a complete accident. And another time I remember, I found him sweeping the hallways.
Well,
had a cone. And I said, why don't you let me do that? But, you know, it just, he saw some dust balls and he thought he would, you know, get the broom out and sweep the hallway. I don't think he did that, but you know, I just thought, well, it needs to be done, so I better do it, you know, so...
And you got the impression with this sort of thing from him that it was just sort of natural.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it wasn't, none of it was affected, like this Bergoglio character now.
He wasn't putting his humility on show?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I mean, it wasn't, you know, on the Swiss News Network or whatever. Knowing Lefebvre personally, knowing the Archbishop personally, and you see it, how he would act, all of this seemed quite natural.
Yes,
and in character.
Yes, he was not pretentious at all. No, not at all.
You know, Your Excellency and Father, you both come from backgrounds where you acknowledge that you've run into people, you know, that were in the Novus Ordo Church who maybe had some personal piety to them. And, you know, sometimes, you know, I was asking for funny stories, but I think part of it is there are so many pictures of Archbishop Lefebvre where he's laughing or smiling. And I think those of us who never saw him, never met him, get the impression that he was just generally a happy person. He was obviously talking about some very dire things, the crisis in the church and that sort of thing. But there are many circumstances where he's smiling. Can you talk a little bit about how that particular aspect of his personality was present?
He was generally a very even-tempered, pleasant person. I mean, I can count on one hand the times that I... Well, maybe two hands. The times that I saw him get worked up He did, you know, have an angry side to him. Occasionally he'd get worked up, but he most of the time was very even-tempered and pleasant. Always in control of himself, though. There was never a time that he was not in control of himself, except maybe those angry moments. But you know, as a rule, he was absolutely calm and pleasant to everyone. It's nice to be around. You know, everybody was happy when the Archbishop was there, and when he left out on the trips that he made, you felt a little insecure, slightly, you know, abandoned. You just felt better when he was there.
In fact, he joked about that once, because of course he was the only bishop that was around to ordain us at that point. And he made a joke at a conference saying that he can almost hear when he sneezes or coughs in the back of the chapel, the seminarians sort of pray all together, "Oh God, please let him live till he ordains me."
Yes, he had some sort of lung problem at a certain point, which made him go into a very severe coughing spell. Nothing life-threatening or anything, but it sure sounded like it.
Yeah.
And you didn't know that he had this condition. You just thought, well, you know, this is it. He's giving up the ghost. And he would do that fairly often, have those coughing spells. And I remember thinking that, oh, my goodness, you know, this is the end for him. But he lived a long time.
My second year there, he was right behind me in the chapel. Would have those fits occasionally. Like that. But having him behind you was, of course, a good motivation to kneel up straight, right? For any seminarian.
Go ahead, Your Excellency.
No, I just say he was a pleasant person.
For those of you who are just joining us, you're listening to Clerical Conversations on the Crisis. I'm your host, Stephen Heiner, and we're joined by a regular guest, His Excellency Bishop Donald Sanborn of Most Holy Trinity Seminary in Brooksville, Florida, and Father Anthony Chicotta, Associate Pastor up at St. Gertrude the Great Catholic Church in Westchester, Ohio. And today we've been talking about Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre, sort of the personal side. A lot of the times when we read about the Archbishop, we read about sermons he's given, but there are so few people around today who've had a chance to actually meet him, work side by side with him, and both His Excellency and Father had a chance to meet him. Your Excellency, Father, I've asked you this question in other interviews, other contexts before, but I think it's an appropriate time to re-ask that question here. How do you think the Archbishop was looked at in the traditional movement at the time of his death, and how is that different now, some 22 years on? Or is it not any different? What is the assessment of him from the traditional Catholic perspective? And when I say traditional Catholic, I'm painting that broad swath of all the MOTU people who just found out about the Latin Mass last week, all the way to your seminarians down in Brooksville. What was the assessment in 91, and what's the assessment today?
Well, it's awful broad, but I mean, certainly he flew the flag and he kept things going. And, is a significant historical personage from that point of view, and certainly gave hope to a lot of us, to a lot of people throughout the world, and kept the... as it were, the opposition to Vatican II going and on life support, and certainly even built it up.
Yes, that he did. I'd say this, too, that you wouldn't have any MOTU, you wouldn't have any indult, you wouldn't have any of those other things if he had not done what he did. If he had not insisted on retaining the traditional Mass and denouncing the new Mass, and if he had not built up a resistance to it throughout the world, those modernists never would have conceded even jelly beans to the traditional movement. That I think should be said, that they have what they have because of Archbishop Lefebvre, whom they condemn in principle. So that's my opinion anyway. As far as, but you know, you have a broad spectrum there, but I think what Father Cicchetta said is accurate, that in a general way, he did keep the torch of anti-Vatican II going, and he kept the torch of the traditional mass going. And from that point of view, I think everyone sees him as, to a greater or lesser extent, a rallying point.
Let me follow up on that question. If that's the assessment, broadly speaking, what is the set of the contest assessment of the Archbishop? Because I think this ties back to my original question of people being in shock that you'd have such nice things to say about the Archbishop. When you deal with your seminarians, when you deal with the faithful, people who either know or don't know the Archbishop, what is the Archbishop like from that perspective?
Well, I mean, you keep it on the level of ideas. I mean, his personal virtues are a separate issue from some of his ideas, which were incorrect, and his approach to fighting the battle against Vatican II. So it's a division between the person and the principle on the level of ideas.
He set down all of the principles of sedevacantism, but never drew the conclusion. His pointing out that Vatican II was the source of all of the problems establishes the principles of sedevacantism.
Yeah.
Or his pointing out that the new mass is something wrong establishes the principles of sedevacantism. As a matter of fact, Cardinal Saper in 1974 cornered him on that very point. Are you saying then that the mass that the Roman pontiff has promulgated to the entire church is wrong, that it is evil? Is that what you're saying? That was the question, essentially. And Archbishop Lefebvre understood the whole, exactly where he was going with it, and he backed off. The answer should have been, yes, I'm saying that, and then the next conclusion would be Paul VI is not the true Roman pontiff, because the church is incapable of promulgating something evil. But he understood that, and you see, that's why I say he gave all of the principles of sedevacantism, but never drew the conclusion. Assess him.
And when you say that, Your Excellency, I think about that famous quote from the suspension in 1976. Were either of you, were both of you back in America at that point, or either of you in the seminary when he gave that speech on his suspension on Dezinis?
I think that was that the hot summer one, the Lille speech? I was in the United States at the time. I think we all were, because that was in August. Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's right, yeah.
I wanted to read that, and I wanted to know, then or now, if you would take any question with what he said here. And for those who've never heard this from the Archbishop, having had a chance to reflect on what he did and what His Excellency just shared about that story of Cardinal Saper, what it means to sort of stare at this precipice. So this was on reflections on his suspension in 1976. He says, "We are suspended ad divinis by the conciliar church, from the conciliar church to which we have no wish to belong. The conciliar church is a schismatic church because it breaks with the Catholic church that has always been. It has its new dogmas, its new priesthood, its new institutions, its new worship, all already condemned by the Church in many a document, official and definitive. This is why the founders of the conciliar Church insist so much on obedience to today's Church, prescinding from yesterday's Church as though it no longer existed. This conciliar Church is schismatic because it has taken as a basis for its updating principles opposed to those of the Catholic Church. This conciliar church is therefore not Catholic. To whatever extent Pope, bishops, priests, or faithful adhere to this new church, they separate themselves from the Catholic Church." For people who look at that, and now with you got the strict observance of the society, where it's saying they're trying to get back to the principles of Archbishop Lefebvre some people would say, well, look, here are the principles of Archbishop Lefebvre. You know, why dodge what the Archbishop said here? Did you agree with what he said in 1976? Do you agree now? And what do you think the implications of agreeing with that quote from the Archbishop are?
Well, I think that is one column that belongs in the right-hand column of Archbishop Lefebvre. But I could cite to you other texts that are so accommodationist and reconciliationist, so to speak. As a matter of fact, let me finish that sentence, that are equally accommodationist as that is anti-accommodationist. I mean, there are many, many quotes and acts, facts, things that he did that point to the soft side. So that's point number one. Point number two is, I think in that speech, in that very speech, he makes reference to reconciling with the modernists at the end. I'm almost certain it's in that same speech. You have to look at the whole Lefebvre. You can't look at an isolated side of him. He never abandoned the idea of reconciling with the modernists. He never actually ever abandoned it. And I think that was the tragic flaw. He is, you know, almost like a Greek tragic hero, you know, somebody loaded with all of these virtues and power but that one flaw of wanting to reconcile with the modernists ruined a lot of. I mean, it ruined him in the sense that it put him on a contradictory path, and so you can double column him. And you would say, is this the same person speaking?
Mm.
See, you know, so the one cancels the other. I mean, what was there? I would, in most grosso modo, agree with. I mean, there's a few things I would alter in it, but I could put another quote against it that would dissolve all of that. So it has no teeth.
Which is why you know, a year or so ago, when the controversy came to the fore in the Society of St. Pius X between Bishop Follet on one side and as an accommodationist, and the other bishops on the other side as supposedly non-accommodationist, that they both could cite the Archbishop,
yes,
and be perfectly correct,
yes.
You know, in one column and another, the left hand and the right hand column, and that is indeed the tragedy.
When you're speaking in contradictories, the truth does not cancel out the falsehood. When you're speaking in contradictories, it what happens is that you just get you get nothing. In the sense that neither is correct, neither is true. Both are. I mean, the truth does not redeem the false in a contradictory situation. So, you know, what is true? Is it his soft side or his truth or his hard side? You know, and whatever you want. That's the problem with them, and I think it was a tragic flaw, that idea that he originally had of getting his society approved in these various dioceses. That was the precise reason of going to Covington, if you recall. That was in that whole idea, and at that time that seemed to be a correct thing to do. But what he did not do, I think, was develop with as the Novus Ordo developed. I think that, you know, he should have said at a certain point, well, it's obvious, just exactly what he said there, obvious that this is a breakaway religion and that we can have nothing to do with it, and then draw the practical conclusions therefrom. But he never did that.
And from our own point of view, I remember listening to these different statements that he made, the sort of the right-hand statements, and you would think that, well, maybe he finally is going to do it. But of course, he never did, because he would turn around and say something else that would be accommodationist. So obviously, that was quite, quite disappointing.
Yeah.
But he could have had the whole thing in his hands and done, I think, much more than he did you know, to against the errors of Vatican II if he had stuck to the hard line. But
yes, which is typical of saints, to stick to the hard line.
Yeah.
I mean, look up the lives of especially saints who are opposing heresy. Find one that has in any way soft-pedaled the heresy, either in word or in act. Find one.
Yes. Well, I, Your Excellency, Father, I don't think anyone would expect to hear anything other than the words hard line in any sentence associated with either of you or with Restoration Radio in general. But I suppose I want to tie into what you're saying and sort of bring our show to a conclusion today by talking about those who, like me, when we came into the traditional movement, Archbishop Lefebvre, as you say, is a sort of monumental figure. We looked at him, and so how many times have I heard someone say, well, the Archbishop was never set of a contest, so that's why I'm not set of a contest. I'm not smarter than or holier than the Archbishop. And you've just given them a whole bunch of ammunition about how the Archbishop was a holy man. So, I mean, how do we know better than a holier person? I'm just going to so I'm a simple Catholic. I don't know anything. The Archbishop was smarter than me. He didn't go set of a contest. I'm not going to go set of a contest. There are quite a few of our listeners who find themselves in that camp. I was one of them myself years ago. How would you respond to them?
That the Catholic Church transcends Archbishop Lefebvre. You know, that Archbishop Lefebvre was, in many ways, a great man, that he was a great bishop, but that the Catholic Church and its sacred doctrine and theology far transcends any one person, and that the criterion is our conformity to the principles of Catholicism, not our conformity to an archbishop, one archbishop in the church. Because you could take that same argument and apply it to the whole Novus Ordo hierarchy. Look at all of those Catholic bishops of Vatican II, how they were very pleased with Vatican II. Who am I to say that Vatican II is wrong when only a handful of bishops were opposed to it? You could take exactly the same argument and apply it there. So we should all be blowing up balloons. You know, it's true. You know, if you're going to apply the argument of authority, where do you end up with the argument of authority? The we follow our, and that was one of the problems we always bumped into with our European brethren, was that we followed the Archbishop to the extent that he was faithful to the principles that he had enunciated to us, which were in conformity with the teaching of the Catholic Church. And if he deviated from that, either whether in thought or in fact and in deed, we would deviate from him. That we would not follow him down that path, that we always held to that. And he always knew that we were of that mind, and he was always uncomfortable with us Americans for that reason. And don't forget that all of us had been in Novus Ordo seminaries. A lot of the European seminarians had not been in Novus Ordo seminaries. We had witnessed firsthand all of the horrors of the Novus Ordo, and we wanted nothing to do with them. And also we had fought against our superiors and the rectors of seminaries and various other individuals set over us based on Catholic principles. That was our weapon, so to speak, Catholic principle. And we were ready to do the same if ever the Archbishop Lefebvre were to present us with something that was not in conformity with Catholicism or its practices or disciplines. That's what I would say.
Yes, and particularly the last part is something that, you know, I'd like to emphasize, that I saw many very holy and very edifying men compromise the Catholic faith. And the fact that they were personally holy and personally edifying and had good intentions was one thing, but you cannot stand together with someone who compromises the Catholic faith in any way, shape, or form. And so it was always in my case, and certainly in the case of I think all of the older Americans who got involved with the Society of St. Pius X and Archbishop Lefebvre was the question of principles. It was Catholic principles and Catholic doctrine we were there for. And if someone did not represent those principles or contradicted that doctrine, it was time to go.
Well, I think all those points are well taken. For those of you who are just joining us, you're at the tail end of our show on Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre. This has been our second episode of Clerical Conversations on the Crisis with our regular guests, His Excellency Bishop Donald Sanborn of Most Holy Trinity Seminary and Father Anthony Chicato of St. Gertrude of the Great Catholic Church. I've been your host, Stephen Heiner. And I just want to take a second to kind of tie in that, you know, back in the wild, woolly days of traditional Catholicism, there wasn't a seminary. You had to, if you were an American, you had to go to France to find a seminary, but you don't have to do that here in the United States. We have several choices, and one of them is His Excellency's, which I had a chance to visit recently. Beautiful, peaceful. For those of us who are in the world because we're lay people, it's a great place to just escape. Be without internet and just spend time in prayer. And if you'd like to know more about the seminary, if you'd like to send a contribution to the seminary, it will be well spent. There was a young gentleman from Nigeria who was just ordained to the subdiaconate in the last couple of weeks. So just around the corner from Nigeria, coming all the way here to America to get ordained. So there's a lot of good work going on there. If you'd like to know more about their work, make a contribution so you can get His Excellency's newsletter, go ahead and send a large check to Most Holy Trinity Seminary. No amount is too small or too
large.
We're
still waiting for yours, Stephen.
I've sent one recently, actually. In fact, I will send another.
The point to say that you're breaking up.
no amount too large. To 1000 Spring Lake Highway, Brooksville, Florida, 34602. Again, 1000 Spring Lake Highway, Brooksville, Florida, 34602. And if you know a young man who might be interested in the seminary, write to His Excellency and maybe make an introduction. It may not be someone who is confused, as we were talking about where the Archbishop is, but they're maybe just confused about where the Catholic Church is now, and they could get some straightening up, and Bishop Sanborn is just the person to do that. If you would like to know a little bit about what Father Chicata is doing up in Ohio, he's got a website called sggresources.org, and there you'll get all kinds of links to various things that Father Chicata has taken upon himself, and he still has lots to do, even though people like me keep asking him to do more things. If you haven't had a chance to see, he's got some videos on his YouTube channel. So if you go to youtube.com/workofhumanhands, you'll see some of the videos he's done on the Mass. He's been accommodationist for those of you who don't want to read a 500-page book. He's done 6-minute videos for you per chapter. Those sorts of things aren't done for free. So if you'd like to thank Father, well, they are done for free, but of course, if you'd like to thank Father for his free work, you can write to him at 4900 Rialto Road. That's in Westchester, Ohio, 45069. Again, 4900 Rialto Road, Westchester, Ohio, 45069. Your Excellency, Father, I know you're very busy, and I caught you at the end of a normal school day at the seminary, so I will leave you to your rest, but thanks so much for joining us, and I'm sure everyone will look forward to our next episode.
Thank you, Stephen.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
This program was brought to you free of charge by the sponsorship of Novus Ordo Watch. See for yourself that the Church of the Second Vatican Council is not, in fact, the Catholic Church of the Ages. Go to novusordowatch.org. That's NovusOrdoWatch.org.